with campuses in Vijayawada and in Hyderabad, capital of startup state Telangana. KL ranks 38 years of engineering excellence in shaping the complete student. KL University employs higher order teaching pedagogies, driven by globally renowned faculty. State-of-the-art research department with additional focus on industry-driven skilling have been paramount in attracting 500-plus MNCs to engage with KL, resulting in an impeccable track record of 100% placement over the last 14 years.
At KL University, we concentrate on overall development of the student. Along with the academics, we give equal importance for all-round development of the student.
Faculty at KL is made up of eminent faculty from premier institutions in India and across the globe. With more than 500 faculty holding PhDs and 550 more pursuing PhDs, KL leaves no stone unturned in edifying higher education. Academics at KL are divided between our faculty and a roster of acclaimed international and guest faculty. The usage of teaching pedagogies like flipped classroom, project-based learning, learning, and deep and blended learning. Faculty at KL certify a holistic education for every student. Lab taken to class allows students to receive a more hands-on education, with a deeper understanding of concepts and practices. Our fully flexible choice between credit system empowers the student to hold the reins of their education. About adding another dimension and expertise to a student's arsenal. We keep our eyes on the future, while our feet firmly rooted in the present. In an exciting association with National Skill Development Council and engaging the best in the industry and domain experts, KL has introduced
thank you. Good afternoon, all participants. Welcome once again to the faculty to the second day of the faculty development program conducted by Department of Computer Engineering, KL University. Yesterday, we had a good time in sharing knowledge with Dr. J. Ravikumar Garu on IoT for real-time applications and Dr. M. Suresh Kumar Garu on advancing marine aquaculture and its scopes and opportunities. It's time, we are waiting for resource person. Just few minutes, please wait. We'll start the session.
Hello, madam. Hello.
Sir.
Ain't late to start this. No?
Chadama, sir.
No, in kind kandi. Okay, the speaker join here.
Waiting for the speaker.
Waiting, sir.
Okay. If speaker is joined, you can
yes,
start.
Sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Madam,
sir,
if time permits, you can play our university video also along with the department video.
I already played, sir. Again, once okay. Again, I
no problem, no problem. No.
Okay, sir.
Hello.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, Dr. Suresh Kumar.
Good afternoon, sir. Yeah. Sir, good afternoon. Sir, could you able to hear me?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Sorry for the delay.
No problem, no problem.
I was in confusion whether new link will come or what. I don't know.
No, sir. The same link has been given for you for 2 days.
Okay. I was not aware of
Sorry, sir. Arna, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
You can start the session.
Once again, good afternoon to our participants. And just now we got our resource person for today's session. And I have already been telling you that yesterday's session, Dr. Suresh Kumar Garu on advancing marine aquaculture with artificial intelligence and IoT scopes and opportunities. No doubt it was a wonderful session and lively session which covered why AI and IoT and what is marine aquaculture, futures of demands, and then aquaculture production, marine aquaculture concepts, and how AI and IoT can be phenomenally contributed towards this scope, its crisis and opportunities, what not, many more we have shared. And now it's the time to go with up the second session with him into deep learning into this topic. And I would like to introduce our resource person once again to all the new participants who are there here. Then our sir, Dr. Suresh Kumar Bojjada, Assistant Chief Technical Officer, Mariculture Division, ACARCMFRI. ICAR, just see what is this, an Indian Council of organizations under the Department of Agricultural Research and Education, Ministry of Agriculture, Farmers Welfare, Government of India, formerly known as Imperial Council of Agricultural Research. It was with 101 ICAR institutions and 71 agricultural universities were spread across the country. This is one of the largest national agricultural systems in the world. It's really great, and you can see the different structural buildings around the institutions around the country which were established. And going on to ICAR has played a pioneering role in subsequent developments in agriculture, and food grains. By it has had production of food grains by 5.1 times, horticultural crops by 10.5 times, and fishery by 16.8 times, milk by 10.4 times. And since this development is a marketing development and making a visible impact on national food was nutritional and security, it has played a major role in promoting excellence in higher education in agriculture. It is engaged in cutting edge areas of science and technology development, and its scientists are internationally acknowledged in all the other fields. So going on to the institute, which is established in Kerala, it is a headquarters which is there in Kochi, Kerala. You can see, and the research locations you can see here: headquarters, regional centers, research centers, field centers, and this all around India, where we are gaining a lot of information. But now it is going with AI and IoT. It's really a wonderful thing we have to learn here. And going on to Sir's PhD studies on technological biological innovations in open sea cage farming, and then his patent advice of breeding culturing marine fish in open sea. And it was been technology has been demonstrated and commercialized the patent, and you can see the certificate. And then this is studies on technical and biological innovations in open sea cage farming, doctorate of philosophy. Is a really a wonderful thing from the sir, his studies and research applications. And going to the awards, Technology Innovation Award for the intervention in lobster sea cage farming and integrated multi advantages in aquaculture, National Fisheries in a board of UGC New Delhi, conducted at Andhra University Visakhapatnam during 16-17 December 2016. And see his best 10 publications we can see here, which were displayed in front of you. 10 publications related to optimization of stocking parameters, analysis of fishery and stock of potted cod, and diversity occurrences and socio-economical aspects of snappers, snappers and job fish and stock assessment of Japanese thread fin bream. See, his studies went all around and very deep analysis has been shown here by seeing his publications. And these are the other publications, continuation for that one, and effects of stocking density on growth and survival of this Asian sea bass. When you go on to the open sea mariculture of Asian sea bass, let's Califier, and then when you go on to the capture based aquaculture of mud spiny lobster, see, all these are things where we have a deep knowledge in that, and sir has been done a good job in his career, and we are here to listen to him. And when you go on to the consultancy project, what you have, artificial fish habit based marine ecosystem restoration in the ISOS areas of Gujarat, and feasibility study of commercial scale seaweed cultivation in Gujarat under the project, and then which is worth of 17 lakhs, and empowerment of Pagadia, that is fisherman of the village Bandar village, where in Gujarat, through sustainable marine cage through Kutch district, and then tribal sub plan he is having STP establishment of sea cage farms for the Sidhi Advisory tribe on the coast of Gujarat, and transfer of technology of worth of 1.4 crores. Really, it's a wonderful job with the resource person. We are very honored to have him here to share his views, and he's working on projects, All India Network project, All India Network project on marine culture in-house projects, where he's handling personally his innovations in sea cage farming and coastal marine culture, development and standardization of seed production technologies of selected high value fin fish and shellfishes, and then going on to development of hatchery and technologies of commercially important spices in mariculture. See here, we are studying all these about sir. Why? Because he is here with us to share his views and then to give knowledge regarding this this aquaculture. And yesterday's topics were benefited by that. I wish all the best to all the participants to get more information from Dr. Suresh Kumar Garu, and then yes, he is ready to share with us. Let us listen to him, and we have him onto the screen immediately.
Yeah, thank you very much, Aruna Garu. Just I am sharing my screen. Just please make me host so that I can share. Devi Garu.
Sir.
Could you able to make me host so I could able
to... Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Sir, you are the co-host now, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. I think some new participants also would have been joined, I expect. And very good afternoon all. Hope you are all fine and safe with this pandemic spread of this COVID-19. And please make sure that keeping social distance and be sanitized yourself. And first of all, I thank the chairman, KL University, Sri Koneer Satyanarayana Garu once again, and Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. LSS Reddy Ji, and Registrar, Dr. Kantham Garu, and Deputy Registrar, Dr. Suman, and Dean R&D, Dr. KL Narayana Garu. I think yesterday we would have some interaction, but somehow it was missing with Dr. KL Narayana Garu. And Dean Academics, Dr. Venkat Ram K, and the Principal K. Subbarao Garu, and HOD, and Shivaganga Prasad Garu, and Associate Dean, and Sponsored Research, Dr. J. Kumar Singh Garu, and all the members and coordinators, and who are carrying out this wonderful FDP program for a week. And those who are directly, indirectly, and with the scheme back end and front end, and contributing to this FDP, I would like to thank them. So, at the same way, as a Government of India institution, we have long procedures to get the approval for the any external expert lecture. But I am kind enough, and my director provided me in earliest possible communication for the permission to deliver the lecture, because we have some restrictions on expect lecture delivering because of the IP and other issues. So I would like to thank my director of this FDP program and all. By the way, I'm coming to the point. Yesterday we have discussed very as for my expertise and being a researcher, past 15 years I was spending with the onshore and offshore farming and this open sea farming, because it's since its inception, by the virtue or by the grace of the God, I was involved, and I was a part in the development of the technology, which is being promoted as a future of the country, especially in the farming sector. So before that, because I hope there are a few more people added here, so I would like to give, whenever I go for a expert lecture, if it continue for a 2-3 days with a overall broad concept, I go through a MILI, and probably how many people you would know MILI, I don't know, but I would like to introduce MILI. So let us see, what is MILI? I think anybody knows this or not, I don't know, but I would like to give a glance. MILI is nothing but most important learned yesterday. So just I will have a quick snap so that you will have a broader idea what we have discussed yesterday. And in continuation to that, we will know what we'll be discussing today. So the connection will be there. So yesterday we have discussed about advancing sustainable marine aquaculture with AI and IoT, the scope and opportunities in this 21st century here. So we have discussed what are the yesterday marine aquaculture and how it plays a key role in the GDP contribution. And we need around 70% of the food scarcity in coming years by 2050. And fisheries and aquaculture plays over a 5% of agriculture GDP and 1.1% of the national GDP. And there are this is going to be an emerging sector in India. So what are the drivers and challenges? We have discussed. And population, one side, the explosion of population is one biggest issue, which need to be promoted for this going with the new technologies and interventions. And aquaculture and its related sectors. See, marine aquaculture also, I told you, it's a subsector of aquaculture, but it's very bigger than the aquaculture sector. Aquaculture generally farmed with the freshwater aquaculture and marine water aquaculture. And generally, we know that freshwater is about culturing crops and and there are a lot of events going on. The limitation is in domestic potential only, because export-oriented aquaculture yet to come in freshwater aquaculture in India. So marine and brackish water, you know, and shrimps in Andhra, we are culturing very huge quantity. Around 60% of the share was from Andhra Pradesh. Overall Indian world seafood market from India. So last year we have exported about $7.8 billion. It's about 50,000 crores foreign trade we have done. So one side, the rising demand for the food and nutritionally balanced food is required. And so that's where aquaculture will play a key role. And under that, this marine aquaculture is going to have a wonderful role. So as well, unlike other agriculture sectors, and future food is from the sea. And you can see witness from many countries and how they have done. By 2030 itself, nearly 2/3 of all seafood products for human consumption will come from aquaculture, which shows the potential and the future of the aquaculture sector. So it's almost 46.4 million metric tons are required. That's what this FAO, Food and Agriculture Nation, has projected, this projection, where the wild catch capture fisheries are coming down and aquaculture and its growing sectors are going up. This is the trend for the coming years. So what are all the drivers also we have discussed yesterday? What is the provoking and the motivating factor for integration and bringing up the AI, IoT, and machine learning techniques in the sector? And the one is population, climate change we have discussed. I think we missed some interaction with Dr. Narayan Garu regarding climate change and all. He wanted to express some discussion, but I think hopefully today, if he is online, we'll be definitely having a good discussion on that. And another side, seafood demand is increasing and it is never coming down, and every day by day it is increasing because of per capita consumption all over the world, and not only in India, because of the food consciousness gaining importance, because healthy and nutritious diet every day, day by day, it is gaining importance because of purchasing power, because of the ideology and all, it is changing. And domestic global potential, consumer preference, and reduced availability of the species in the wild, disease uncertainties, and resource availability and effective utilization, and sustainable low carbon footprints. This is one of the most important, and the technology and all the things, it is transforming the sectors. But that transformation should not be in the cost of sustainability or the ecosystem degradation. So that is the one of the prime concern we must take care. Though you all may be into different sector, different domains, in the computers or maybe electronics, maybe into the some legal people and all the things, but we must ensure in the whatever sector we are there, but it should not have the development at the cost of sustainability. So, and we must always ensure that the low carbon footprint, we should promote that kind of technologies. When you see the aquaculture and all, when compare with piggery, poultry, and other meat development, though the aquaculture will have very less carbon footprint because the FCR is very high, food conversion ratio is very high, the high energy diet is being given into the system. And I have also discussed yesterday with Dr. Jay Kumar Singh's some query regarding the what about pollution and the what are the factors that would provoke, because when we are going for high energy farming. So I have expressed that what is the, with the data and scientific data available, and how we organically we can farm the fish than any other food processing and food producing sectors, especially in the animal food, animal protein producing sectors. And here you can see the inorganic nitrogen, so that it's organic and inorganic nitrogen, how it dispenses. So organic nitrogens are releasing from the aquaculture sector is very high. So it will not much harmful to the ecosystem or degradation. So when we are intervening with some chemicals, some antibiotics, then only the issues comes. And the limitation of land also we have discussed, the rising demand for the food, and we need to meet 70%, it should get up, because otherwise we cannot meet hunger and poverty will be there. So the next we have discussed was the climate change and what are the challenges in future, because sea surface temperature is rising. We know everybody, it's 1.5 degree Fahrenheit, it was elevated. So sea levels are getting up. So therefore, a lot of global warming things are coming up. So that eventually affecting the fishery also in the wild catch, because that is the another source where the people are getting good animal protein. So around in the, this is the 1860, how the fish population in the sea, and now today 2006, this was the data, how the reduction of the fish. So you will not have in future by 2050, the collapse of the fisheries in the entire oceans will come up. So in such kind of circumstances, we need to come up with intensified farming systems as well. We need to integrate with the latest technologies like artificial intelligence and machine learning algorithms, and as well with IoT integration. These are the one of the most important, and it is going to transform the sector like anything, because even anyway, it is predicted to be in the coming 20 years and 30 years, and phenomenal contribution and phenomenal transformation will be there because of the AI and artificial intelligence and these IoTs. So, and we also examined that this FAO report, around 90% of the wild stocks have been completed. It is overfished in the sense, because the indiscriminate fishing methods have been used for the catching the fishes, because using smaller mesh size and all. So now if the same trend is going another 10 years, there will not be anything for in the sea. So there are adoption of these technologies like artificial intelligence and remote sensing based technologies. There are team, they are working on this kind of wild catch fisheries, how they are going to give a better advisories, managerial advisories and policy makings. So this is the way we have discussed yesterday. And the possibilities of implementation of AI and IoT and machine learning, because 62% of food fish will come from aquaculture by 2030. So there are two possibilities. One is intensifying the culture techniques and diversifying the systems and species and integration of this machine learning and AI IoTs. So I have also discussed about the Government of India decisions and the move like a revolution. So how government is giving more importance to aquaculture sector, among that mariculture sector, among that sea farming. We must shift to, from land to sea, because land is limited and we can't expand. Urbanization is going on very rapidly. So we cannot use more land. The pollution is already there. Therefore, we are, even every country, a lot of countries are shifted to ocean. Most of the food from ocean. You may take seaweeds, you may take fish, you may take many other things, but it is coming from sea. We know sea only for non-living things, like oil, gas exploration earlier, and sea route shipping and all. But now government is taking such an initiative, like a war-fitting move, because you never seen such kind of decisions by Government of India. And they have completely deployed a new ministry, Ministry of Fisheries, Government of India, for the implementation of this development, and targeted to be raise the exports by 2022-24, 1 lakh crores. So it's a foreign exchange. So to double that production and farmer income, there are good amount of schemes have been launched, around 20,000 crores launched for Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana and sea farming in the Blue Revolution Mission and Blue Economy Goals. It was set more than giving importance of oil and gas, transportation, shipping, all these things. And at the right now, you can see Atmanirbhar Bharat. In the Atmanirbhar Bharat also, there was huge fund allocation, 11,000 crores for the marine and inland sector and aquaculture development and sea cage farming and all. You can see the internet also, and you can search in the Google also. It implies that government is very serious on that. So we have to make a move, and it is a very good right opportunity to the all the people in the from the end of students, from the end of faculties, from the end of researchers, all together. We have to come towards, put forward to a move stating that a multidisciplinary approach. I mentioned yesterday, we must have a multidisciplinary approach to gain the goals, because I will have a specific expertise and you will have specific expertise. And it was a combination when we are implementing this kind of IoT and artificial intelligence, we must have a multidisciplinary team where somebody who has the expertise in computational background and who is expert in the electronics and material sciences and all, so chip designing and all. So these are the approach we need to take up. So these are the opportunities. So why we should implement AIoT and what is the key role? That also we have discussed yesterday, and how, because it will be useful for resource conservation, and we are limited because our resources are very limited. If you take like water resources also, I have discussed yesterday, stating that freshwater resources are coming down. Even you can see the Clean Ganga project and all the things, because this is for the freshwater scarcity, and only water we have that in the sea, marine. So that we need to take the opportunity, and crisis has to be taken up. So output efficiency, the more output efficiency can be obtained from the AI and IoT in this sector. So environmentally friendly. So as I said earlier, we must take care of environment in all times, because we must give the same earth to the next generation. We may for the, our children and children's children. We must have a vision, and we must have a complete comprehensive approach with the sustainability. So what are all the upgradation will come, and equipment and intelligence and network and unmanned operations. This is what the next generation, and this is what the going to happen in Ocean 4.0. So we have also discussed about sustainable development goals, how it is going to achieve, because every country, as we are all into the part of the UN governing council, and this is, we have signed then for the compiling the sustainable development goals. There are 17 goals, and among that, these IoT and artificial intelligence, ML, these are all will contribute to the goal number 9, industry, innovation, and infrastructure. This is another goal, very important goal among the 17 goals. And indirectly, directly, this supports to other goals also, because no poverty, zero hunger, good health and well-being, and quality education, all the things will be covered, and even life below the water and climate action, especially out of 17, more than 7-8 it is covering. So you may not feel the gravity when you are doing. You may feel that it is very small thing, or sometimes very meager, very mere, but it is not so. But when you look at it to the broader perspective in an international platform, and if you take it into the account of the environment, and as well with the comprehensive sustainable development, and IoT AI is going to play a wonderful role. And also we have discussed about Black Swan event. So it's another rare and unpredictable event which occurs in the world and the globe, that called as a Black Swan event. So it happens very rarely, like World War and Fukushima nuclear blast, all the things I have discussed yesterday. So this has been taken as an opportunity. Every Black Swan event created one or another opportunity. So such kind of opportunities we must take care. We must utilize, because now COVID crisis also created such kind of environment where we can go ahead with the untouched, unmanned, because it creates, because from here upwards, more influential diseases may come, and where it can influence the crops, influence the fishes, influence the poultry, maybe any livestock, including humans. So by using this, we can have such kind of opportunity in the crisis. So the possibilities and the scope, and we have discussed where this can be integrated. One is culture practices and culture systems and culture species. So in these three sectors, if you take it as a three different domains in the farming, so in the three domains, we can integrate these technologies. So we have also discussed about how the application and what are all the areas. Okay, the data management, analytics, and deployment of management, monitoring and management, visualization and research, application development, device management, system management, and heterogeneity management. And these are all the application of IoT and cloud platforms. And this is the cloud architecture which where people are using. And these are all the some of the devices, is the underwater unmanned robotic operations they are doing for the survey and this thing. And this is the sensor. And this is the one of the cloud-based multi-vendor inventory interpolatory source. So where the culture system is completely monitored with the devices. So there are applications. Hello, is it continuing?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, because I get some interruption. My voice is clear?
Yes, sir. Clear, sir.
And we have seen all the things, what are all the available IoT applications and all. So finally, it improves the feeling and avoid mistakes and reduction of cost and traceability and all the things. So it is going to be three and it's a very big market, $308 billion by 2050. So we have great opportunity. So today we'll be discussing about how to shape the future farming in India and applications of artificial intelligence, machine learning in mariculture. So some of the part we have discussed yesterday in the IoT part. Okay. And today we will be discussing shaping the future. So why we should shape and what should be our goal when we are implementing this kind of technologies, and what should be and why. And development and adoption of ecosystem-based comprehensive models, this especially AI and IoT and machine learning, and it can lead to a sustainable development of humankind. Why I'm telling always sustainable? Because ultimately, if we are not sustainable, we cannot continue further. So our in future generations are in stake, and we all, and we are seeing the climate resilience, how it is coming up, and climate actions also, how it is coming up. So in each part and every part, these can be a part. That's what we need to take the sustainable development in the humankind. And as I said yesterday, industry, generally they call as a 1.0 to 4.0. Today, in the concern to this, we are into version 4.0. So earlier, how the aqua farming and all, it started traditional, very conventional way of leaving fish in the pond and harvesting after some time. And then equipment has come, some mechanical power and electricity has been introduced. So when it's 2.0, it started in 19th century, then it continued further up to 20th century. So when 3.0 version has come in the aqua farming and industry, you can say, automation has come and computational, operational and software has come. And the 4.0, and today we are in the 21st century and it is an unmanned production and AI, IoT's era and machine learning era. So considerations for adoption. So what are all we should consider while developing? One is farming system. So what kind of farming system we are using and what for we are developing? That we must have an idea. And species. Species are another one of the important factor when we are developing AI or ML. So because each species will vary their body structure, in the sense it looks maybe okay, and it's similar to fish, means it has the gill and it has the tail and all. But interspecies wise, there are variations. There are certain factors which can be tracked out precisely. And precision farming we have discussed. How precisionly we can go ahead with, so that will be with the AI and ML. So husbandry practices, automation. Husbandry practices, a man can make a mistake, but machine cannot. So adapting the machinery into the mankind level thinking, thought process, this is very, very important. So husbandry practices, as a derived husbandry practices, if you could able to automate it, that will be useful for the farming community. And environment, as I said, and economics. We must always consider economics. Today in India, we think technologies are coming up new, but not so. We are indigenously adopting and designing. We are designing for our atmosphere and our country. But if you take into the worldwide, there are much more advanced what we are thinking. That is available. But why we are not taking? Because of the adaptability, because of the cost effectiveness. So it may not be feasible as we develop the technology. That's what even cage farming, if you see, we have developed in 2006 institute. Then later there are several designs have developed and distributed throughout the country. But same things, even advancedly, it is available in the other countries. But in India, what we have done, that same model may not be suitable here. We need to develop some new model, which is really, it is practically applicable to us. That's more important. That's where every country is taking up research in a big way. Another thing, user-friendly. When we are designing anything, it should be user-friendly, unlike more complicated or complex procedures, complex devices. We must have very, simple and, user easy. So that is one of the most important consideration we must take into the account, and adaptable. So these two things are very nearing, because user friendly and adaptable. Some things may be very easy to use, but people one or another way, they may encounter some issues. So because of that, they may not able to adopt it completely, or sometimes the production may not be available in such kind of quantities. So adopting and making them available, this is one of the important aspect of this consideration while developing the techniques. So how to shape the farming? So as I said, roughly a third of the world rely on the fisheries and their primary resources and food. And it's only set to increase population growth. We must convert mariculture process from an art to science using artificial intelligence, data processing, and ML techniques to identify measurable patterns in feeding activities and strategies to present to farmers. This is one of the important aspect, because feeding activities, as I said earlier, if you take a farming activity, the fixed cost and operational expenditure, it almost 60% operational expenditure covers by for the feeding only. So precisely we should monitor the feeding activity and the intake of the fish. And these two aspects are there. One is tracking the biological response, and second thing, and automation. And both should synchronize in such a way that when they required, they should find that the time of requirement, the time of need. Then they should have a sensor to sense it and release the feed. And as well, the level of satiation for the feeding. I'll give you an example. Sometimes we can put a cage fishes. So automatically there is an auto feeder which can feed them continuously. But the wastage will be increasing because of non-sensing. So it should sense with IoT objective, and as well the data transmission all together. It should come to a comprehensive device. Then only it is most effective. Otherwise, if you develop simply with a single objective use, it is not fruitful in a farming system like a marine aquaculture. So when especially these feeding objects are very, very important, where we need to concentrate when we are shaping the aquaculture. So there are auto feeders are available with the stream farming. But why I'm not telling that, land-based systems are entirely different, because you will not have sea turbulence. Sea turbulence is one of the most dangerous and challenging, because you will have wave height, you will have wave thrust, you will have current and wind velocity, and each parameter are interrelated to each other. So even though I said only three parameters, it has lot many parameters which influences the object. You may deploy tomorrow one object which is good for the shrimp farming in inland. That may not be useful, because it has the thrust, it has the many other compliances. So these kind of issues we need to address. So that's what in India yet to come this kind of research. So that's where we are concentrating with a biological expertise. What we need, we know. If you could sense it and develop a device and make sure that it can work out well, it is really wonderful. It is phenomenal in future in terms of business. Because I was a visiting faculty for Entrepreneurship Development Institute of India, EDII. You may be knowing it is very prestigious institute in Ahmedabad. So I visited as a visiting faculty there for a couple of times, because there are a lot many entrepreneurs will come in that. There are people who really want to take such kind of technologies, but it's not available. So who has to do that? Because of the subject biological expertise, people cannot. Yesterday, as I told, simply developing a temperature tolerant or temperature control devices are something different. And adapting to a marine aquaculture or in the sea farming sector, it is entirely challenging, because the devices are very simple and it can be installed, even air pollution devices and even humidity devices. These are all common, quite common. That's what I didn't even discuss, because I could get the information, but I don't want to make it again and again, because you all people may be well acquainted with such kind of IoT and AI/ML applications. Many of the people you are working, I have gone through your website also. I have seen the agriculture drones and all, because it is quite common. But where I want to give a thrust on this is on our, especially in the marine sector and sea. See, because this is going to be a big resource for us, even for food and everything in coming years. And you believe me, if I see the vision of the government of India and as well the movement, and if you could opt, and it is the right moment to take the opportunity, if it can happen, it will be having a tremendous impact in terms of economy, in terms of jobs, in terms of industry, everything. So coming to the point, so technology, as I said, technology must be adaptable and empowering for the farmer, seamlessly tapping to the existing sensor, feeding systems, and camera on site. So collect the data through multitude and AI algorithms to optimize the farmer's performance, and from the cost efficient use to feed to maintaining fish welfare. Fish welfare is another one of the most important point when we are shaping the marine aquaculture. So we are shaping the aquaculture in terms of devices, in terms of sensors, but the ultimate importance is animal. See, you may invest on a device which can produce 1,000 tons, but ultimately if the animal is not coming out with a desired harvest size, and you will be in a losing end. So one of the most important thing is where we need to concentrate is on maintenance of fish welfare, behavior and its growth, everything which we can track. And this is one of the most important and in fact quite challenging. Why? Because water quality, it won't change very quickly in an open water, because it is a sea. So it may give proper reading, and if at all changes also, very linear and very slow changes will be there. But fish, it behaves differently. It's a live animal. It behaves differently. When it behaves differently, you must identify that behavior and the cause and the reason why it is so, and what is the remedy and mitigation to that. And that has to be done with the artificial intelligence and machine learning techniques. And you may need to integrate with the IoT and cloud things. And we need to consistently interpret the data and apply correlations. When you apply correlations with the fish activity, surely you will get a good result. So we can identify the feeding patterns and through sensor data and food particles and other historical information in the real time. When you get the real time information, you will have very good idea on this thing. And we must have correlation and predictions on the fish behavior and how it acts. When temperature rising, what is the situation? When algal bloom comes in, what is the situation? So sea is a real lab where we can learn more and explore more. So such kind of data interpretation and correlations has to come up with these algorithms. When it comes, surely it will have a very good result. So this is the another AKVA group. They have developed this kind of sensors. And this is underwater feeding and fish health operations with the sensor. How the risk management, it will give the cloud-based environment through. It will have the immediate alerts. And these are the feeders, auto feeders. So where it will feed it. These are all the, it will comes under the IoT. This entire machinery, it can control with a mobile. When it's a simple technique, and it will intimate you that what is the fish condition inside and how much it took and how much it needs to be. Further, it should be fed. And this is, you see some interesting. If you see this, this is a caged fish, which is intended to grow for a 6 months period to raise it around 1.5 kilo, 1 to 1 kilo to 1.5 kilo. So what here, there is a device which is with a computer vision and tracking the feed pellets. See each feed pellet size also it may measure. And the they're constantly learning even AI with that every pellet which is eating and which is leaving, both are tracked. Once the tracking, that measurement of the each pellet was there, and that measured pellet coming out. Once the measured pellet has come out, and the wasted pellets and the consumed pellets both will be calculated into the highly precision model. So what it comes, and as I said, when it has the such a financial implications, about a 60% of the complete fixed cost is running on the feed. So sorry, 1 minute, just I need to have some water. So uneaten pellets, sorry for the interruption. So this artificial intelligence, it observes the wasted pellets and as well consumed pellets, so that how much fish can and how much releases as energy, that also it can be calculated with the linear integrated models. Why I'm telling, if a protein content is there in a pellet of 40% or 60%, 50%, and the conversion of the feed to meat is around 1:1.2 or 1.3 kilo. That means 1.3 kilo, if the fish is consuming, it will grow 1 kg. And every day, if you are giving 4 times a feed, so each time how much it is taking and how much it is leaving and the wastage, how to arrest. So that the feeding and the feed monitors, this in this we can fix the timer. So timer and the releasing the quantum will be fixed so that it will automatically broadcast the feed. So the desired quantity. And each time today, fish may take some more feed and tomorrow it may take a little bit less because of water quality parameter may not be good or fish health may not become. So that also even artificial intelligence can predict and execute. So that tomorrow what it needs, we know, and how much feed it comes with, we know. And if the feeds 10 kilo of a feed tomorrow feeds, and how much fish biomass will grow in that, that also can be calculated and it can be known. That is the one of the beautiful thing with the artificial intelligence and these IoTs and machine learning techniques. So this is the integration of the three sectors. And if just imagine, and the thing which is done with the AI with a single click, it has to be executed through manpower means. It is a Herculean work, and people has to go with the feed. The feed will be measured in a non-accurate methods. It's hardly 1 kilo or 10 kilo. They will take a gross into the weightage, and they go and they broadcast. They won't mind whether fish is taking, and fish something may take and something may leave. And sometimes he may have his own assumptions, and sometimes he may own hesitations to do so. So one, these mistakes can be avoided, and see such a transformation with a single click. If we start for a morning feeding, it needs a person where morning he has to come and measure the feed and take the feed to the farm and give the broadcast the feed, and he has to come back again. Generally 3 to 4 times feeding will be there for all the aquaculture farmings, almost all, majority. So when it is happening, just a person can come and take and go, and for a complete day, he will be fed up with the work, first of all. The second thing, we are not so accurate whether it can be. But in this system, if you see, if you observe this thing, it is really wonderful. Such kind of indigenous can we do can we do such kind of indigenous intervention? Can we real? Because Indian minds are very good minds, and like you people, like good academicians and researchers, and you know, few more people who are into the sector, industry, and all, we could able to join together. Can we do this kind of wonders? Because Indian coming years, coming, I think it is not so far. The next 5 years, it is going to transform entire seas with the sea flowers, nothing but cages, where we, the target is to produce double the farming activity. That means the production which is being produced now around 15.5 million metric tons, it will be 30 million metric tons in coming 2024 or 25. Then only 1 lakh crore for foreign exchange can happen. So surely sea farming will have such kind of major, you know, major key player in that, because as the land is limited, shrimp farming is having its own barriers. So marine fish will come into the play, and sea farming and sea cage farming will come into the very big way. That's what we are making a spatial planning. So entirely this class will take into you entirely different mode than your regular classes, regular expert lectures, because I don't want to go into the how you measure the temperature and the temperature measuring device, or some IoT with other water quality monitoring and all. But I want to take into the something different level where you can have good exposure with this. So the classification process, how they do it. So the Bayesian models also implemented in the numerical models, and the video-based computational vision will be taken into the framing, and the framing will be classed into the different classes, and the classifiers will be layered, and that will be examined in a numerical manner, and the label will be created into the different classes. This is the overall theme and the core architecture of that artificial intelligence and machine learning process. This is actually a machine learning process. And it can, based on this data generated, we could use volumes data will generate. That data is very, very important, because data is going to play a very big role in coming years. And big data along with AI, IoT, and machine learning, these are all deadliest combinations in all the sectors. See, as I said, why this sector is very, very important than any other sector. As I said, you can go through the many references and online if you, after my class. Past 30 years, the only sector which is growing more than 6% in average growth throughout the world, not only in India, and highly stable sector. This is the only sector, aquaculture. Among that, marine aquaculture. The second point, the UN prediction, FAO, Food and Agriculture Organization, United Nations, it predicted that coming 30 years, the increasing trend will be there in this, and 6 to 9, and it sometimes touches to double digit, like countries, India. So India is a great country. We have great potential. We have great people. We need to coordinate each other. We have to plan in a such a manner that we'll come up with very good output. So we can make good sense. So this is the one spatial network, how it works and feeding decision-making with the machine learning and artificial intelligence. Decision, because that's one of the most important thing. I think some people raised their hands. Somebody wanted to interact or what? Two people raised their hands.
Let me check, sir. Can I allow them to talk?
Yeah.
Ravikumar Garu. Ravikumar, sir. You can raise your question, sir. Vijay Kumar Garu. You can unmute and you can raise the question. Sir, you can continue, sir.
Yeah. So the feeding better decisions. So these better decisions is basically based on the fish behavior in the culture system, and upon that, based on the data what it gained and observations made, because earlier we are the observations, everything upon the man-made observations, and based on we take decisions. Sometimes it may go positive, sometimes it may go negative. So when we see the spatial network and motion network, with that there will be memory network integrated, and the feeding schedules and feeding decisions can be taken up. So this will completely render very good efficient feeding and cost reduction, and ultimately the per unit output, cost of that unit output, it will be minimized. So when you are reducing the waste and all, automatically the pollutants, whatever organic or inorganic, whatever way, there will be some impact and minor impact. When you compare with other sectors, fisheries is very less. And among that, even though there will be some small effect, that will also be eradicated. Therefore, the sustainable ecosystem-based approach can be implemented. So this is one integrated farm. You can see this is the caged fish, where this is the feeding, and it will give the feeding disposal. From there, these are the cameras which can, with computer vision, it observes, and as well the sensors will record the complete water quality and all. So these machine learning techniques will implement with automatic feeding controls and all. So efficient feeding techniques would adopt, and real-time surveillance will be there with this kind of wireless environment monitoring, and IoT and cloud services will be integrated in that. So that sea lice is one of these, is the Norwegian model, where the sea lice is a parasite which severely affected to the Norwegian salmon farming, because salmon is very, very big fish, big in the sense, very big marketed fish. So underwater unmanned surveillance, and even today, as on today, there is a robotic operations for net repair and net damage and inspection, all the things are coming up. So AI in mariculture farms must offer constant analytical and objective evidence of how fish grows and responds to farmer input under different conditions, allowing meaningful data exploration of different feeding strategies. I have said that, and I'm just going through this script. And the system leverage could be infrastructures to be provided, remote site level analysis and anomaly detection to further expose farmer site dive, and it will give the insights. This is another paper which I have gone through yesterday. They have reviewed all the researches happen in the optical sensors, because if you want to observe the fish and this thing, optical sensors are very, very important. We do have some optical sensors for pH, salinity, conductivity, all the things. But here there are developed for specific species and all. Then fish skin, even you see, when you keep in the water, fish skin color also, it can be identified through optical sensors and before pre-harvesting. And it is with a spectrophotometer, portable spectrophotometer, and this single camera, and fish size, stereo vision. So it can track a number of fish at a stroke. So dual camera, single cameras, these are all the some cameras which developed by these are the authors. So what they have developed was, so dual cameras which can track even more accurately the fish length, weight, and it can be calculated with the truss networks. These truss networks are the simply head to length to tail, tail to gill, gill to mouth. All the measurements, you will get automatically what is the fish weight and how it is. These are the truss networks which we said that were implemented through these optical sensors. So fish species identification also nowadays they are doing with camera, and behavioral studies. So all with the camera sensors, these are the which we need to develop in future. So there are cameras which we can, individual fish behavior also can have multiple fish, already I have spoken. So feeding behavior, abnormal trajectory, water quality assessment. Water qualities are quite common. That's this thing. And after post harvest also, after harvesting also, what are all mechanisms are required, like sorting fish, because harvest sometimes some people may require specific grade. When they need grade, we have to, okay, 1 ton we can grade it, but when it is, I have showed yesterday one video where they are taking 100 tons in a single cage. In such kind of circumstances, with man-made things are not possible. In the sense, it takes long time and fish quality will deteriorate. So fish sorting missions and mission vision system and fish quality, skin color and all as such, and freshness of that one. Even today, freshness of the fish can be detected. I think you would have seen last year, and using formaldehyde, formalin in fish. So that was big debate in the markets. Fishes should be banned from formalin they were implementing. So the freshness of the fish can be tracked. And the same well, hyperspectral imaging system and physical and this physical attribute security. All these things, these hyperspectral imaging systems we have been used. And texture, freshness, pH, fat content, moisture, microalgal spoilage, lactic acid, bacteria, blood and melanin spots. All these things can be, we can detect it. So these are all the others who has developed in there. So what we can do in such kind of indigenously developed IoT and artificial intelligence can be, because that's one of the most important area. Without these sensors, we may not able to achieve this complete fruit of the AI and ML. And anyway, X-rays are there, the physical attributes and chemical attributes and food security, all the X-rays you may be knowing. So this is for a glance. I have referred yesterday in a very good journal. This is a very good journal. So I have taken that consideration also. So these are the machine learning algorithms and the learned models from historical data in mariculture. Historical data are obtained from farm practices, yields, and environmental data sources. Associations between these different variables can be obtained by applying machine learning algorithms and historical data. Now, these are the typical machine learning approach, like tiring data and this labeling and classification and all. This is very common, basic of a typical method. So the input has to come with the data, and even the machine learning can predict the values between two missing values, and so that missing values can be predicted accurately and it can be generated very reasonable value. So the feature selection and manual extraction, so hand designed features and classifier and shallow structures, so then we can get the output. These are the basic approach and the structure of the machine learning. So farm closure prediction, these are the some of the uses how the machine learning can be used. So farm closure prediction, sensor network based approaches to predict the contamination event using machine learning methods. So if you take this site selection methods, we put the cages in near to the shore. So there will be an industry, there will be a port, there are many other things. But there are industries also, there are highly lethal pollution releasing industries, like some plastic industry and textile industry. These are highly carcinogenic pollutions they release. When they're releasing, if they're releasing to near to the cage site or fish farming site, definitely it will be a problem. So this kind of tracking and identification with machine learning, so that in a mass scale, we can implement these farm closure predictions. So algal bloom prediction, as I said earlier, machine learning based methods, it can be used for algal growth and bloom. And it can be, this also can be implemented through remote sensing based data, because chlorophyll data is there, which will give the real time data by the satellite. So we can obtain the data from the satellite and implement the machine learning algorithm, so that automatically wherever that bloom is there, the direction of the bloom will be detected. So that I already told missing values estimation. Anyway, that you people are knowing how the values will be estimated in between some missing values. So that is one of the important, because in data put situations will come. Now, from the 21st century only, we have the idea of AL and AI and machine learning. So now onwards, data may be, we may have a large quantity of data. But in the last decade and previous decades, in the 18th century, we may not have data. So some data will be in the form of, experienced people and somewhere in the written books and all, but not in the numerical models. So what we need to do is, such kind of data poor situations, what will be the best? Today, if it is this, what is the condition of the long back? After 10 years back, what would be the situation? So these kind of predictions can be done with the missing value estimations. So sensor data quality assessment, sensors, because validation is one of the important, because sensor, we would tell, data produced by the sensors are sometimes faulty. So that faulty things can be, we should validate that one. The decision-based faulty sensors reading will result a wrong conclusion. So that is one of the important and key factor where we have to concentrate on. So until unless we are validating the sensor, it will be very difficult to relay the figures. So preventing disease and tracking prices. So diseases are the next big cost driver, and something AI can ready, it can address it quickly. Program can predict disease outbreaks before they happen by annotating, collecting data, presenting it, and applying preventive measures. So I feel this is one of the best area and where AI and its allied techniques will play a key role. Because as I said earlier, we may deploy a big cage of 1,000 tons, but if we are not harvesting up to the last day, it will be difficult. Because that may be mortality may come because of the diseases or some pollution from the factories or some other mishaps. So all these things need to be tackled. But tackling in a human way, it is not possible and it's not so easy. But whereas in machine learning techniques, we can easily implement such kind of results. In order to train machine learning methods, it is required to prove the historical label data. However, when a farmer aims to set up a new marine aquaculture firm, historical farming data is not available for the location. So that relocation model has to be implemented. So in between two locations, what could be the water? Now we have done this one with interpolators and extrapolators. Or kernel extrapolators we have used here for the data extraction between two sites. There is a current value, velocity, and wind velocity in some water quality parameters. So what we have done, we have taken randomly some distance. In between the distance, what would be the possible parameters values that we have estimated as well? Benthic habitat mapping. So benthic habitat mapping, in order to get an understanding of the aquaculture habitat on seafloor, the researchers sometimes send autonomous underwater vehicles to collect the seafloor images. The images are later visually analyzed by the researchers to produce the habitat map in the region. So this is a biodiversity concern. Our institute is completely, our division, biodiversity division, is there in our institute. So they are restoring corals, coral restoration. In the sense, corals are one of the most important biological, organisms where it will maintain the ecological balance of the seas. So nowadays, because of the pollution and all, corals are dying. So when it is corals are dying off, so they are planning to rejuvenate the corals with the planting, coral planting. So what they're doing, they are taking some of the healthy implants of the corals and they are planting. So every time we come, such kind of circumstances, estimation of this kind of seafloor and measurements these autonomous underwater vehicles are used. So as well, there are sensitive zones like marine national parks and biosphere reservoirs where we cannot enter. Therefore, these kind of underwater unmanned vehicles can be sent for the research and seafloor images. So these are some of the computer vision sensors. Just I put it for you. And water quality monitoring, because water quality is a very common, that's what I have not given much thrust on, water quality monitoring my the apparatus and devices. So aiding mariculture sustainability efforts, because it will aid to the sustainability. The potential of AI in aquaculture does not simply end with local farm economics. The system can provide the potential to power data-driven insights into aiding to the environmental and sustainability drivers of the sector. All the same way, AI algorithms can measure the poor feeding that contributes to damaged flower beds and provide real-time insights before this occurs. In the future, it is our aim to provide industry compliance across the board to increase the sustainability efforts. So, AI, in starting itself, I told you, AI it is going to play a very, very important role in achieving sustainable efforts, sustainability. So these tsunamis and this climate action, the rainfall, everything is one or another way we are related. Whatever our dues in every day, there will be a relation. And that correlation has to be identified and we should correct ourselves if something is not proper. So that will be leading by now AI and ML. So this is one of the, this thing, biomass and disease tracking in quarantine. So I will put a video so that you will have a very good idea.
iFarm can substantially swim through the iFarm sensor as they rise to the surface in order to fill their swim bladders.
This is a quarantine system. See, in a pool of fish, it can be tracked and the symptoms can be tracked. The biomass can be estimated and the parasites can be counted in each fish in a pool. Could you be able to see?
Yes, sir.
This is the quarantine pipe where the diseased fish has taken into separate quarantine block in the cage system itself. See, this many big pool is there and the fish which has been infected and is completely monitored from the top command room. So the estimation of biomass and fish welfare, interactive feeding. So feeding also, interactive feeding, the amount of feed which is given and asked, that much only will be given. See how the fish is being quarantined. So here, so escape warning. If some fish try to escape it, so that also can be tracked. See, after treating them, so there will be a treatment possibility here with the pipe through. So therefore, it can be treated and later it can be released into the stock. Is it the presence on? Sridevi ji.
Pardon, sir.
Is the presentation is on?
Yes, sir.
Yes, do you please respond to me because I was a little bit, you know, quite.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So you have seen the animated video, how it's been developed. So you must think what we can do the best. So it's not that it is not possible. We have indigenous technology. We have the case system, what they have developed even better than that. We have developed with the less price and it is cost effective. Now it is going in a big way. So here in Gujarat state, there are 250 cases, about 40 crores has been given for the implementation of the project. And last year we have started that one to the stakeholders. And under RTVA, they are planning this year to coming 2 years. So 5,000 numbers, individual cages. So it will be used amount, use money will be pumped for that. So if anybody can come this kind of interventions, surely we it can have good impact on that. It is a beginning now. We are onto the beginning at right moment and improving the environmental footprint and providing the possibility to standardize and reduce the cost is just a start of AI in mariculture. Going forward to it and intended to AI system to be automated, entire aspects of the feeding process, bringing significant increase in the productivity and lowering the cost for the consumers, apart from all the animal well-being. So that's one of the important thing which we need to be considered. So this I can conclude that this is one of the point where we need to start. Whatever we have done, it is a platform has been created now. So now it must start in that kind of. So this is a common, and why we are discussing at this juncture, especially in the mariculture. To be frank, I was completely engaged in my projects and all. Actually, I was not having time. And the time was also very less for this expert lecture. But the only my intention to interact with you people is the only thing that someone can come up with the good intent. And moreover, I have seen the university profile and all. It was a category one university. That is another reason why I was into. We were having ideas and all with the collaborations and all. But there are young and good minds are there in KL University. I have seen there are people commercializing the drones. There are people doing with different kind of IoT applications and all. So I thought, whatever time, I must give an expert lecture because we can have an interaction so that future something can materialize. That is the only intention I was in. So CMFRI initiatives, especially.
Sir, 1 second. I think one participant want to raise a question. Sachin, yeah. Malode, sir. Can you unmute yourself and you can ask the question? Sachin Malode, sir. You can unmute yourself. Sir, you can continue, sir.
So this sea farming activity, it is well practiced in Norwegian countries and later in 70s, 80s, it went to Japan and it was, they advanced with the technologies and all. But in India, we have not so, because of the production, we are into the second place around the world, among the world. So already inland production was more, but in the future demand and the recession in the complete inland farming, some diseases and all, the government thought that we will go ahead with moving to the seas in 2005-06 and during that time. So when they started, indigenously developed cage should be developed. So this kind of farming system, because I told you one cage itself, we can produce 100 tons, 200 tons of quantity with a limited space. So we have started in that kind of design. This was the first design which we developed. In fact, it was my PhD under the project. So now we can try for this kind of devices. We have seen the quarantine device, and I will show you some more things which we can have a glance insights on that. So this is indigenously developed case system, which is better than the Norwegian, which is better than the Japanese. So it is highly strong and sturdy, and it is withstanding to all over the country, all the seas. So such kind of successful design we have developed and tested. So that time also we were using some solar indicators and all, but not so much. We were into artificial intelligence or IoTs and all these things, machine learning and all. But these are the feeding operations and man-made observations with the scuba kit and all. So because I used to go for observations on my hand, because until unless we are getting farm expertise, we will not have the command on that. So that was the reason we were going. So later design was simplified into smaller versions, and now complete coastline. Almost all over India, hundreds of cages have been deployed by the institute, and it was transferred the technology, and demonstrations have been continuing, and adoption of the technology has been, you know, it's increased like anything. Even there are stakeholders from Karnataka, Maharashtra, all over the all maritime states, they are taking up. All these coastline, we have tested the cage size, including Kutch, because I was there for Tata consultancy project with the Tata CGPL, Coastal Gujarat Power Limited and Tata consultancy. We were there. I was designing that cage system and all for the Kutch. Then even Adani group also, I was a consultant in the project where we have implemented this technology for a community benefit in the Mundra port. There are fishing villages where fishermen are evacuated. So they wanted to give a livelihood with this cage systems, and smaller versions have been designed. In 2018-17, we were working as a consultant for Adani also for a year and two. And Tata also we have worked. Then from there, even from public-private entrepreneurship partnerships and all, it was coming up. This was our institute farm at Karwar, Karnataka, where when all these things are conventional, it looks, but technology-wise, it is good and very cheap and cost-effective. But the thing we need is artificial intelligence and machine learning and IoT synthesis. So once that is done, it will be wonderful in India. So this is me, and we were growing a fish in that, and not only one fish, this small cage, this is a 6 meter cage, which can produce 6 to 7 tons of biomass of fish. So you can just imagine like this, it needs only a 6 meter area. 6 meter area into net depth is around 6 meter. So these are bigger size or one, it is 30 tons production capacity, this cages. So this was the harvest we were doing. This is in Gujarat. This is in Karnataka. This is in Gujarat. This is in backside of Somnath. We have 24 cages here. Six big farm is there. We were handling now. So these are the species. Lobsters, one of the most expensive commodity, which is going for live trade. So these live traded animals, it grows within 3 to 4 months, around 200, 250 grams. So observing these things, we used underwater cameras and some sensors and all, but it need to standardize it, and you see, we need to develop this kind of this thing. With this is 1 kilo, 1200 rupees in India itself, and when it is going for international market, most of the produce is going for international market. So I was working with African tribes here in Gujarat also as a project, the tribal supply, which I've been. So these are the lobsters which grown in the cages. These are all, and because of this farming system, this president got Pandit Deen Dayal Krishi Antyodaya Upadhyaya Award, which is a prestigious national award for him because of this intervention. See, we do use the water quality. Ah. This is a water quality sensor, which we record the complete cage location. You see, this is the feeding observation. Every day feed will be given and kept it inside with the feed. So lobsters will come and eat. Okay. And we just again, every day morning, we dump the feed there. It's a trash fish given because it is an experimental one. We are doing R&D, we are using this. But we can put the artificial feed with the automatic feeder, which can feed them. Automatically, based on the timing setting and timer setting, we can distribute the feed to them. So such kind of interventions has to come up. So we could able to develop this much. Now we are planning for this integration of artificial intelligence and all the these things. This is the harvest. You can see how much quantity we can take out. This is the shellfish, the lobster. We can take 600 kilo to 700 kilo in this thing because it is very priced commodity, you know. So after 4 months, we could able to harvest a very good amount of quantity. So this also we observed with underwater cameras and all. We used to maintain the entire this seawater with optical sensors, say pH, salinity, DO, temperature, all the things. As well, we track the chlorophyll content and all with the satellite remote sensing. So in Japan also very high tech, including the stocking of seeds also they are doing with machinery. So that even sashimi is one of the biggest favorite food. That means a fresh fish with cutted with a very high quality meat. They take the raw, this thing, the red sea bream, one of the species, very good priced one. And so they are using now artificial intelligence and machine learning, IoT, to make sure that enough meat in the national plates because they wanted sashimi grade. Sashimi grade is very premium product for them. So the another one of the most important milestone we have achieved was so remote sensing and GIS-based spatial discovery for potential mariculture sites along territorial waters of Arabian Sea coast. We have developed a model where we are planning for integration of artificial intelligence and machine learning techniques. Because even in continuation to that, we may integrate with IoT also altogether. Because we have detected the complete farming zones throughout the Gujarat coast. We have taken a territorial boundary of 20 kilometer area and we set the model. This model was analyzed in different patterns with geostatistical analysis and modeling. So physical parameters, oceanographic parameters and socio-infrastructural parameters we have taken. And these are considerations. Then the data was extracted from different sources. One is from remote sensing and satellite data and secondary data. All the data are extracted from there. We did multi-criteria evaluation model and AHP execution. From there, the suitability map generated and the constraints and everything, the scenarios are created. With this simulation also we have done. So based on that, we could able to find very good locations around 11 lakh hectares, say suitable for farming. These are the non-suitable areas and these are highly suitable areas where we have reclassified the data. From there, the distance from each port and all. Now we are planning for ocean superclusters here where the possibility and the feasibility is very high with the road and all the networks. So we will be integrating this for inclusive and integrated ocean supercluster in future. So these are the some parameters, how it, the distribution patterns are there. With we have taken with the remote sensing and the satellite based data. So these are the final maps. So this is the way we are planning in future with the cage system. You have seen And here it our indigenous cage, if you think, there are sensors, there are optical sensors, there are underwater vehicles, there are cloud system, there is an IoT which is monitoring the drone, and it is given to the analytics, the fish will be identified, and all this is the architecture we are planning for, and it is essential. So this robotic will help the digital farming and precision farming and hybrid yields and better quality and less resources, and in the sense the energy wastage will be very less. The computer vision and machine learning algorithm, it can track the conditions and recommendations can be given with the decision support suggestions. So these are in the agriculture also. So the next generation, the Ocean 4.0, yesterday we were discussing, it will be completely unmanned operations. Even you see surveillance drone which were deployed at this cage farm site, and you can see the sensors here, and these are the drones which are landing into the sea. So yesterday I showed another thing. This is the one of the big achievement by Sea Station, by InnovaSea, these aquapods. This has around 20,000 sensors in it, which can produce 50,000 tons of fish in a single crop, and deployed at Norwegian seas. So it was built in China shipbuilding, shipbuilding company. So what I'm telling, what I was articulating to give input to you, this may be the larger scale. We must think big. We can have pilot models which can be smaller in scale. That smaller scale can be tested, because if you take Andhra Pradesh, we have very good coastline where you can try it, and even Andhra is a good enterprising state. People will come forward, because these are all looking for people. See, something we should think something new, newer than the thing. Shrimp farming is going to be outdated. Now the new farming technology, fish farming, is coming up, marine fish farming. So that is one of the most important milestone. Government also thinking to go full thrust on that. So this kind of cages can be developed with a mechanical engineering people and structural engineering people, and naval architectural is engineering people, and IoT cloud-based people, and a biological expertise all together. If we can develop this kind of models, integration with the AI, and it would be fantastic and wonderful. So these are unmanned drones and all, it is there. As I was going, these things are, there are people who are planning differently and coming to us. And I have a person who knows, he came forward for with a proposal, planning for a different kind of cage systems, and completely operated, man-made, remotely operated observations. And that was the area where they are thinking. I was going for Regional Institute of Management as a visiting faculty for them. There also, these kind of enterprising things are going on. They are asking for many collaboration, and this kind of new technologies, they want to market it, and management, even aqua management, farming management is an upcoming big sector, big developmental area, it is coming up. So these are the unmanned underwater drones. So, which requires specialized and expensive human interventions. So such interpreting, inspecting underwater cages and damaging holes, this will be very useful for the system. So these are some of the examples. These are the overall integrated system comprehensive model, which has been developed at Norway. So what I could conclude in the session was, the future of farming depends on largely on adoption and continuous solutions. While large scale research is still in progress and some applications are already available in the market, the industry is still highly underserved. When it comes to handling the realistic challenge faced by the farmer and using autonomous decisions, decision making and predictive solutions to solve them, farming is still at a nascent stage. So this we should accept, because we develop many things, but how far we are commercializing that, how far we are taking to the farmer, lab to land, farm to lab to farm, this is one of the important aspects. And there are companies who are developing that is not cost effective, and sometimes it is not adaptable and more complex. And as well, at the same time, we have the opportunity to develop such kind of developments. So in order to explore the more enormous scope in the AI and agriculture, aquaculture, all the things, application need to be more robust. Only then it will be able to handle frequent changes in external conditions, facilitate real-time decision-making, and make it use of appropriate framework and platform for collecting contextual data in an efficient manner. So another important aspect is to exorbitant cost of different consumer solutions. That's what I was mentioning. It should always cost effective, user friendly, and simple. This kind of these are one of the barrier, you know that there's another strong barrier bottleneck in the development of this AI and IoT, all these things. The solutions need to become more affordable and ensure that technology reaches the masses. An open source platform would make the solutions more affordable, resulting in rapid adoption and higher penetration among the farmers. First, we need to make them habituate. So with this, I want to conclude the session. So I'm sure India is going to into the next generation farming technologies, and sure, sea farming is going to play immense role in coming years. It is a great opportunity, and it's in fact, it is a early bird for everybody. Whomever coming and taking the early bird opportunity, they will be the pioneers in that. So surely we always contribute towards a sustainable blue economy through Blue Revolution mission and all. So with this, I want to thank all of you. And now it's open for discussion and any queries.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. I'll open for question and answer sessions. Participants, you can unmute yourself and you can raise the questions. Meanwhile, Dr. Jaikumar Singh, sir, is there with us, sir. Jaikumar Singh, sir, can you throw some light on these interactions, sir?
Thank you, Dr. Suresh Kumar.
Thank
it was
you
so wonderful,
much.
Like yesterday, continuing the same. And yesterday's my questions were answered today. Two of the questions with the real-time data, the kind of sensors you have shown, some of the papers also reviews what you have mentioned. The two basic questions were answered from biological perspective. And with institutional perspective point of view, there are two teams in the Keele University. One team from ECE department who are into GIS technologies, integration with AI and ML. They already are running programs with ISRO and DST. There is a team which is doing this. So that team is very much interested in your topic based on the PPT, and they want to interact with you. And there's also another team, which is atmospheric group, who are doing the atmospheric modeling. There's a big team with us, group of people who are working in that area. We are already supporting the Andhra Pradesh government with weather forecasting. Okay. So with every day, we release the bulletin to the IMD. We support the IMD and also to the state government. We give the bulletin through KLU. There's this link is available in KLU. You can also look at the weather forecast team, which is, and they majorly depend on the high performance computing facility available at KLU. So there's a high performance computing and all the simulations are run on that, and the forecasting is being given to the IMD and to the state government. So these two teams are very eager to interact with you. I request your precious time sometime during this COVID so that they can contact with you, and then they wanted to have a personal interaction so that they can be a part of the collaborative team which is already working, and try to submit some funding proposals from institution side. And overall, I would like to thank you once again for taking time for the 2 days, consecutive days, and giving a wonderful outlook of the research going in the marine farming. And I am sure this would be the next gen technology for Andhra Pradesh also, because most of our coastline would be benefited with these technologies. I have a very basic question again. We do not have much of the marifish culture. We do not have much of the marifish market in India. No. Do you think this technology is going to be adopted for in-house or most of our market is freshwater fish? Either the hello, no. Am I audible?
Yeah, sir. Yes.
So most of our market is based on freshwater food rather than seafood. I mean, sea fish. We are more used for freshwater fish and prawn cultures. So is there in-house market? Obviously, throughout the world, there is a huge export market. I agree with that. But can this farming replace the freshwater farming? Or you would say freshwater farming should be going on, and this technology also should be adopted for the export market.
No, sir, Dindis will have a very good question you have asked. But I would like to know whether you eat fish or not, marine fish.
See, I'll tell you. When I was there in Europe, I was bound to have only marine fish. I mean, sea fish. There was no freshwater fish available if you are in Europe.
Yeah.
But it tastes different. We are used to freshwater fish. So the consumption in India is mostly freshwater. So can these technologies be adopted even for freshwater? If so, how does this mimic the freshwater culture? Does it mimic, does it give the same output, or it is only suitable for marine culture? These are my points. I'm a naive citizen of this marine farming, so
I can address you very well.
Thank you once again for hosting this, and I mean for being a part of this program from our side. Thank you very much.
Yeah, it's my pleasure, sir. And you have asked me about GIS based future integration of artificial intelligence and machine learning techniques as a collaboration. And I'm glad to know that you are working and forecasting for the state of Andhra Pradesh, giving forecasting to atmospheric science and team and all. I congratulate them. And 2 years back, I was supposed to be in the government of Andhra Pradesh, but somehow it was not materialized to plan the sea space of the complete Andhra Pradesh territorial waters. So then commissioner has come here and he was having a discussion of a day and took me there into the Amravati and all, but somehow with the positioning and all, my positioning to be into the state sector is not compensating, and so there are some issues in between. So I had a lot of workload with Government of India projects and all. So we would, it was kept on pause. So what I thought, this GIS based works is another important aspect in future. And from your university, Dr. Ramesh is already working well, and he has already given a simulation model which we have simulated here, and we have stability also tested that entire model stability. Now we are into the communicating that into the good journal. Yesterday I told it's a very good journal we are communicating. It's a director also very much interested, our director, on the particular work, because entire Indian coast has to be planned now. Now Gujarat, we have developed the model. Now that model has to be implemented to the overall India, territorial waters. So then we will move to the offshore waters. It is a big area which is left niche, and that need covered. So when we are working with some Government of India organization, you know, there will be a process very lengthy. And surely I'm very positive. Our director is very much interested to develop this kind of artificial intelligence and all the new age technologies into the marine sector. So surely I'm so positive, definitely we'll have discussions in future. We can have a detailed discussion whenever possible. So we will work out how it can be done, and I'll put this into our institute also. They will also take needs a biological expertise and marine expert, and all the multidisciplinary aspects are required to develop this kind of model. Like, and another thing from your university, maybe more time deployment of the people may be required from your university to institute or this kind, because last time some 1 week or something, it was not that much sufficient. Some more days, then we will work out who are the team members and how we'll work it. Step by step in a process, we will go. But as a being a deemed to be university, you can have immediate decisions. But as a Government of India institution, we have a lot of procedure formalities. So this will take in time. But sincerely, we were looking for a good team, in the sense multidisciplinary team. So who can cater, it's a win-win situation for everybody. For you and for us also, that we must agree. So that is one point. GIS based spatial plannings and all, even AI and ML and IoT, and yesterday whatever you have asked, and today and some more things whichever are there. So these things, I think I have addressed still more, because I have not gone some of the issues very deeper, because I am not that expertise in that kind of particular engineering. Like AI and ML. So I know the overall concept and how to implement and how to adapt the technology and what is that basics. This thing I don't know. And as well, because and also I don't want to present the things which are regular. That is the very reason I have not mentioned about many sensors, all these things. I want to take it to the next level, which is emerging, and it is a future and new age. And third thing, regarding freshwater and marine fish. Sir, you may be aware or not, I think you have very less exposure on eating habits of Indian people. The freshwater is highly demanded at northeastern states, where the sea coast is not available. If you go to Bandar and you just ask any marine fish, what is the cost? Because that cost will be very high. You take any commercially valid fish like sea bass, cobia, and pompano, all these things are very expensive fishes. So in Indian market, the product not there, that's going for freshwater fish. The second thing, nutritional component. With why Europeans are requiring more this seafood and fish. Fish has a highly unsaturated fatty acids, UFA and PFA, polyunsaturated fatty acids. So this will build their entire internal, healthy health consciousness and all by eating the seafood. And our people are unable to afford that much money. So they are going for freshwater and another thing. So that's what, when we increase this farming activity, surely the prices can come down, and it will be now food and nutrition security is today's debate for the country and for the world. Tomorrow, after coming the intensified technologies, and a new security will be the big debate, because people can produce trash, many things for survival. We can eat grass also sometimes and live. Such kind of in African countries, you can see how the people miserably live in. But after some more years, there will be a consciousness on the nutrition health security. So the balanced diet, not only carbohydrate, not only other diets, we must have a protein diet. That protein also, which is having highly unsaturated fatty acids, all these things we must have. So marine fish is the biggest resource. Why people are more demanded internationally. And another thing, when this sector develops, almost all employment will generate, and new sector will generate, and moreover, good foreign exchange. That is the status which decides the Indian economy status, the foreign exchange. Though when for everything, if you see China, why they are strong in their domain, because they send everything to out. Even smaller or bigger or manufacturing anything, they will send to other countries so that they will earn foreign exchange. So dollar rate can be coming down after this. Once if you're going ahead with 1 lakh crore exports to the marine sector by 2024 or something, it would create wonders. And once a new sector is coming, and unutilized potential of the seas, that will be utilized. Because as such, you see, nobody is using, especially for farming zones, with the scientific approaches. Now we have tracked the GIS-based planning. So we have identified 11 lakh hectares. Even 1 lakh hectare, if you are using, it will create substantial income. The target will be completed, that 1 lakh crores. So that kind of interventions, if you're coming, the unused potential of the seas will be used, one thing. Second thing, the balanced nutritious diet will be available for the common man once upon a time, egg is not much promoted. But today, in the egg association, every day, daily, one egg they are taking. Tomorrow, there will be a time, every day, 150 grams of 100 grams of fish piece maybe, because of the nutritional importance. So this can be freshwater people are eating because marine production is not that much available. Second thing, and northeastern still states and other non-maritime states, we have, out of 31-32 states, we have only 8 maritime states and some union territories. Rest are all the landlocked states where they cannot have any sea fish there. So whatever sea fish catch and production is coming, you see sea bass, do you know what is the price? It is a minimum of 500 rupees per kilo in domestic market. Even pampano, even cobia, all the, but if you take a freshwater, which is hardly 100 rupees or 200 rupees will be there. So which determines the demand? Demand determines the price. And the 500 rupees fish is costly and demanded. That means people wanted more, but not available. And freshwater is maybe available, but people, you know, does not require that much. The preference is not that much. In a simple logical manner, if you think, the demand, when it is more, the pricing will be more. So we must compensate the production, because I told you why we need to take up this cage farming and sea farming, because one side, we are depleting the natural stocks, destructive fishing methods and cyclones and many other regions, climate change, all the things are affecting natural stock. And another side, land locking. Land is not expandable and already shrimp farming is having its own bottlenecks and pollution issues. So what is left? Now left is the sea. In the sea, if we are taking the potential for the blue economy benefit, so definitely, and new sector come up, everything will be in a inclusive growth will come up. So hopefully I have addressed that your third point also. I feel Dr. Singhji.
Thank you, sir. I request Dr. M. Shivganga Prasad Garu to say a final word before announcing tomorrow's details.
Thank you, ma'am.
Sir, can I proceed? Two more questions are there in the question and answer session.
Yeah, you go ahead, madam. First, you can go ahead.
Yes, sir. Sir, there is a question. What is the scope of research in underwater wireless sensor networks in India? Where can I approach for different algorithms in underwater wireless sensor networks?
Yeah, even underwater wireless sensor networks, even Defense Research Organization, they are also having some collaborations with IITs and all. They are planning as well. That is one of the most important aspect and the area where India need to concentrate, underwater wireless networks. Because sea underwater is entirely different than the freshwater underwater. Because every meter, if you are increasing, the pressure will be increasing like anything. And the device built up, it needs more strengthier devices and underwater vehicles also, even everything, because it most of the thing is based on sensor only. It works as per my knowledge. So we can proceed with, there are DST and many organizations now, they are supporting this research on underwater wireless networks and all the things. But you should prove your innovativeness and all the things. So definitely it is an area which has a big scope in future, because I think you have seen some of the slides here. But even underwater, almost all vehicles and robots, tomorrow robotic era will be coming, where we can operating unmanned robots. So that has to be a good idea, because I think even for you should know the physical oceanography, chemical oceanography and biological oceanography for building that kind of sensor network. So how it is resistant and how it can be stayed and seaworthiness, because the sensor preparation for sea environment is entirely different than the normal inland. So these both things has to be planned in a proper manner. Definitely it has very big scope. So not only DST, there are many funding agencies. I think, I don't know, he is a faculty or a student, I don't know, but faculty means they can apply for a multi-institutional project, or you can apply for a funding for DST. There are CERBI and all. And not only that, even you can approach. They are also encouraging some of the youngsters on a internship and all. They can plan a team and all.
Rasadurai, sir, you can ask your question, sir, because I didn't understand your question, whatever you had posted. Hello? Rasadurai, sir.
Yes.
Yeah,
good afternoon. Sir, this is Rasadurai from Kuppam yeah. Engineering College, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, long back I studied about marine farming and cultures. In this, I have one doubt, sir. Actually, in Tamil Nadu, they will be initiated, but is dropped because of that. It will be affected to normal fishermen welfares like that, sir.
Yeah, actually, that's what why I have placed GIS-based spatial planning.
Yes.
Yeah, because we must have a scientific approach, not like yes, that. See, because of that, somebody will affect. Definitely, if somebody is affecting like more fragile people, the fishermen, definitely okay, they will revolt. Because it is a matter of their food and bread. So,
okay,
it is immense. See, it has an immense scope and lot of area is vacant. We have to find out first, what are the best locations that are suitable. Among that, what they wanted, see, fishermen, traditional fishermen, they may not use entire sea. So they can take some of the locations where geographically, you know, they are doing their own work. They can leave it. There are some zones they can be created, which can be protected by satellite geofencing. So that kind of zones can be used for the farming. If this is what? Unplanned expansion, even in Norway, even in any other country, if you see the case studies, it has a big failures. Like yes, India is more complex system. India is in having more complex system with the geopolitical and socio-political issues. You know, here fishermen will have a political issue. One yes, fisherman strike,
yeah,
it will affect.
Sir, instead of that, whether it is possible to implement like one village or one small
See, fishermen are not bad. They can convene. They can easily convince.
For one village or one mandal like that, we make it. It's very good.
Yeah. Actually, that's what now participatory approaches are coming. That's what now participatory farming is coming up. Farmer, this thing. All these things are coming.
Thank you very much.
Vinod Jatt, sir, you can ask your question, sir. Vinod Jatt. Hello.
Am I audible?
Hello, Vinod Jatt.
Yes, ma'am. Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
You can ask, sir. Raj Jatt, you can ask.
Actually, he posed the question, in which area of agriculture, except of this AI and ML, can be applied?
Yes, my mom asked me
the question is not clarity. That's why I asked him to ask himself. But
there is no area it can be left.
Madam, Jatt is speaking.
Vinod Jatt, sir.
Yeah, he's speaking, madam. You can listen.
Emma. Hello.
Yes, sir. Tell me, sir.
Hello. Actually, I wanted to ask that in which area of agriculture we can apply AI and ML, except mariculture.
Yeah, there are a lot of when crop monitoring, pesticide sprinkling, even drone-based pesticide sprinkling. I think KL University only. Some drone I could see in the news and some information where they have used the pesticide sprinkling and all with the drones. And even nowadays they are tracking with the imagery and computer vision. They are tracking the particular diseases and pesticide, parasites and all. With that they are, and even that analytics based on the chlorophyll and the health condition of the plant that was tracked. And even soil sensors and all, you may be knowing, because I have seen the information and all, but I have not mentioned the soil sensors, how the nutrition profile and all, the nutrient profile and all, that can, that will be real time, it can come. So even how much plant, you know, the plant, particular plant requires water, that all can be predicted through AI and artificial intelligence and these IoT based applications. And this monitoring of the, you know, complete crops, all these things can be done. Therefore, what it can happen, optimization and the cost effectiveness can come and ensure crops will come. So you have the, one more good area is there where LED, you know, and all the parameters if you take weather prediction, and you can give in a crop alternation size, what kind of crop is suggested for this particular period, what kind of crop is useful, all these things can be used with the this thing, AI and IoT.
Thank you, sir. One more question from YouTube participants that seems to be from abroad. The name is Thang Anhau. What are the devices for monitoring water quality? Where can we buy it? Is it expensive?
Yeah, actually, optical sensor based things are very expensive. And which you have seen, I have showed you a video where I am using the one sensor based water quality parameter kit. It was around 10 lakhs. It looks very small, but it is about 10 lakhs. So it gives pH, temperature, salinity and all. So there are many companies in Google, you can search, you will get it with, but the prices are very high. That's what indigenous technologies, indigenous techniques and devices has to be developed. Because see, when we brought, that is from US made. So automatically the prices and all the things are very expensive. So that's where adoption of our own domestication is very, very important.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much. Sir, HOD, sir.
Madam.
The questions have been completed, sir. Yes.
Can I?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Suresh Kumar Garu. Really, we are very happy about your session yesterday and today also. Yesterday, actually, you have we are all tasted about the farming and this marine culture and all. And yesterday, you have given a wonderful session what exactly the role of this artificial intelligence and IoT for farming purpose. And today, you have given a wonderful information about how this particular marine culture is going to be shaped in good way in India in future with the help of AI and ML. Definitely, you know, sir, I have a lot of thought process right now after completion of your session. You know, our department is floating since long back about these courses based on AI, ML, and IoT. Definitely, in future, to reform our syllabi with respect to the farming, which should be linked with the AI and all, your support is very much required, sir. Definitely, I can invite you for a better understanding of this particular student's point of view, how we can transform the syllabi with respect to this role of AI, ML, and IoT with respect to the these marine farming, how we can introduce the some concepts in our syllabi. That definitely our help is required, sir. In future, definitely, maybe next academic year, I can invite you, sir. Your support from that point of view is also very much required for us. And you know, our faculty having a good potential on IoT, AI, and ML also. You know, in future, whatever the projects you are going to handle, feel free to discuss with us. Definitely, the technical aspects, what exactly we want, we may help you. And already our department, our KL University having one project on same kind of a proposal, same kind of a scenario. That is, we are helping nearby farmers by using a drone approach, a drone which is attached with powerful cams. And we are there also, the with the help of the powerful cams, we are observing the and crop various crops of near and nearby the KL University, what exactly the crops are going on, what is the stage, how they are really they are growing in a healthy way or not. Such all the information we are getting through that
drone-based approach, and based on that, we are giving information and advising the farmers in our region language. Like that, we are also planning to, whenever the natural disasters are comes into the picture, definitely the crop will be lose, the farmers may lose a lot. And the time, this physical estimation of such a loss is it's very difficult. And the time, with the help of these drones, how we can estimate the loss of these crops and all, based on that, the farmer may get a good compensation from the government of India or government states like that. Same kind of scenario, we can apply for this scenario also. In that point of view, we are happy to work with you, sir. And in this regard, I am very happy and I am very much thankful to you for your wonderful sessions and accepting our invitation in spite of your busy schedule. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, sir.
Sir, thank you very much for your kind words. Actually, my intention, I already told you, because it need to go in a multidisciplinary approach. Otherwise, it will not result in a fruitful manner. And you have a strength in your own domain, and we have strength in our own domain. So this will be definitely a win-win situation for you and as well for us and for everybody. So this approach we will take up further. And I'm very happy to know that the drone-based approach which you are doing at your KL University and nearby villages, I saw the news also. I was searched employee completely your university website and your department all together. I went and I was so happy to know that and this kind of approach you are taking up. And secondly, definitely from my end, I am very happy to have such kind of collaborative works and all. And in fact, our director is so positive and he is so encouraging. So that he will take up, I will put forward to the with him also. And here, Dr. Divu, who is the head of our division here also, he was also looking for this kind of approach, how we will go ahead with this thing. And he was, that's what, generally we won't get very quick approval for any expert lecture until unless it has a top priority. So, but because of this, my intention and our in-charge intention only director approved immediately and I could get, actually, as you said, I was completely engaged. I think past 1 week, I was sleeping hardly 2 hours per day. So though for preparation of this thing and all, I was spending my time as well with other works also. Because of COVID, a lot of administrative work also there apart from the project and all. So secondly, so I'm glad that if a chance comes and surely I will visit there and we'll have a detailed discussion in one or another manner. And surely we'll, young minds can work well because students can create wonders. I strongly believe. As a student, I started my career and I know what I have done and I have seen the people, what they could do. And definitely young brains and young minds can do wonders. That we need to guide them, just we need to bring them into a platform. Surely we will have that kind of interaction in future. And I'm so thankful to you, sir, for being inviting me and as an expert lecturer with this faculty development. And I would like to thank once again to Chairman Sir Shri Koneru Sachinani Garu and VC Dr. Lils Reddy Garu and Register Dr. Kantam Garu and Deputy Register Dr. Suman Garu and Dean R&D KL Naveen Garu and Dean Economics Dr. K. Venkatraman Garu and Principal K. Subbarao Garu and you and HOD Dr. Swanga Prasad Garu and Associate Dean sponsored Jay Kumar Singh Garu. And we had a very good discussion with Dr. Jay Kumar Singh also. I'm very happy and I'm very glad because it was a wonderful interaction with you people. As you are an engineering background people and experts, so we are into biological expertise. So I always feel that this kind of interaction, it will result very nice. And I also love to have in future collaboration. I'm so much thankful to you, sir. And feel free to contact me. And one more thing, yesterday you have mailed me regarding the application in legal aspect, this artificial intelligence and mail from Dr. Prasad, Mr. Prasad, from law department. Why we can't, whether this can substitute judges in the country or not? And what is the possibilities? I'm sure one or another way it is going to transform all the sectors and it is justice and law also will not be an exemption, because the future will be more effective because of the integration of data. Data-driven judgments, data-driven decision makings, when it will come, that will surely will have a lot of pressure and relaxation. We have very less manpower, judges, lawyers, the case has been filed in a day, the manpower is very limited, and another way it is lagging for years together. In future, after 10 years or 20 years, that much may not be required. But already digitalization of the all the judgments, all the necessary things are going on, I feel, because I have seen somewhere data mining of law, these things and judgments are going on as well. But there is an exception, because justice, honorable justice, will have a discretionary powers. That powers cannot be expected from a machine learning or artificial intelligence algorithm. So definitely up to step 10, it can go, but the decisive step, what they have to take, finally, the judges has to take. But there will be a lot of change and transformation will come for the even justice and judgments also. Even it will reduce the work burden on the people who are into the thing, that manpower. Less manpower and more effective work will come. And the judgments may be hardly they may require in future for only judging, after giving the better suggestion from the artificial intelligence or machine learning algorithms, all the things. And cybertronics, cyber crimes also can be arrested. And the more, I mean, even we are not, that's what one of the negative discussion also, we are not a secret for nothing. No personal privacy, that will not be there in future. So everything will be in that kind of line. So hopefully I address this. If he is online, you can listen, or otherwise Prashant sir, you can convey him my reply. So thank you so much for, I think almost all questions have been addressed.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much. And definitely we'll work together. There is a necessity to work together in future, because after listening your sessions, wonderful sessions, we have to think, and we need to think in that perspective also, to write the projects proposals with the support of this AI ML, how these can be help in a farming. Yeah. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for our wonderful session, sir. We'll do. We'll meet once again in future, sir. Thank you.
This time you have to provide me enough time, because this is such a time I was so tight and.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, and once again I thank Sridevi Garu and Aruna Garu and all the people who are playing key roles from the, screen and on screen and off screen and all. Thank you so
much. Thank you so much, sir. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Aruna, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Suresh Kumar, sir. Dear participants, I think you have a good time this session. And then I want to announce you about tomorrow. Our next session starts tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. on Internet of Things, Technology and its Applications by Dr. A. Kiran Kumar Garu, Associate Professor, Department of Computer Engineering, KLEF. This goes till 11:30. After that, we'll have a 10 minutes time where we can give you time to set up your laptops and good internet connection, because it's a hands-on session which will be carried out by Srimati K. Krishnaveni Garu, Assistant Professor, Department of Computer Engineering, KLEF. I believe we have a good time tomorrow, and then waiting for you for tomorrow's session. And I especially thank our HOD, sir, for organizing such eminent persons and such a good information to all of us and educating us in such a way. And thank you, one and all. Let us meet tomorrow and we'll end the session.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And all of you, Sridevi Garu, Ma'am Aruna, and Dayasagar is the man to do all these things in a wonderful way. Definitely, I have to appreciate Dayasagar also, including Sridevi Ma'am, Aruna, and all. Everybody is involving in this faculty development program. You are doing extremely good. And I'm observing a lot of response from all over India and abroad also. You know, this entire field is close to you only. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.